Nervous is an initiative Bunyan's entrepreneurship had taken. With the support, it's a collaborative effort between Indian Institute of Entrepreneurship and Northeastern Council. This entire proposal of getting through NERIS actually started with us sending a proposal to NEC through our interaction over the years. We have realized that the first point of getting started, that is getting a proof of concept, is very vital for any entrepreneur to take off. And for getting that into that proof of concept stage, people require funds. Like, you know, most of our entrepreneurs are first generation entrepreneurs, and normally that fund is not available with the entrepreneurs. So we looked at providing this grant fund, and we thought that this is the initial beginning. And once we have a success, create success stories through such type of funding, I'm sure the ecosystem will be gradually. We have more stakeholders coming in with the realization there is a need of funding. So what the process that we adopted for NERIS is that we first organized awareness camps all throughout the 8 states of Northeast. In the awareness camps, we not only did it in the city, state capitals, but we also went beyond, say, state capitals. In Mizoram, for example, we went to places like Yongle, in Manipur, we went to Churachandpur, etc. So we tried to reach out. We contacted a number of entrepreneur associations, gave press releases, and we followed the entire process. We did awareness program. Finally, fully completed forms were 695. Out of the 695, we shortlisted 200. These 200 went through a round of pitching, which we had some of it in Guwahati and some of it in the state capitals, after which we have selected the 50. Now the 50, when everything was going, then this pandemic happened and we had to, we were undecisive as to how we go ahead. Now then we finally decided that let's go digitally, and it's also an experience for us about some challenges, some advantages of going digitally. And then we finally decided that yes, we'll go digitally, and because originally what we had planned was we would have 2 days of boot camp in Guwahati, where we would be covering all the sessions that we are covering since today. We started the boot camp today, and then the event will be of 2 days, in which we had identified 8 sectors which has relevance to Northeast. And these 8 sectors we would be covering, you know, we would have discussions on various topics. So waste management was one such sector we had identified. And for each of the, to make it very, very relevant, what we did was we identified entrepreneurs who were a part of our advisory committee for different sectors. For the waste management, we had renewable. We, now that we are having it all through webinar, we decided that let's not club it together. Let's have waste management as a separate subject and discuss. On waste management, I specifically relied a lot on Ochitra Borgohai. I really like thank him for all the support that he has given, because he's a success story. He's from Guwahati. He's built up his own company. He's come back to Guwahati and started his e-waste man. And so I basically leaned on him for all the support in terms of constructing, in terms of designing the waste management session. With that, I would like to...
Oh, the voice breaks and do not hear. Hello. Not audible, sir. Not audible.
Project.
Oh, the voice breaks and it is not audible, I think.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Still breaking up.
I'm almost over. So
Nothing is heard. Yeah. Yeah, no, I do not hear anything.
Yeah, good afternoon. Am I audible? This is Amitabh from IIE. Am I audible to all of you?
Yeah. Hello. Yeah. This is audible. This is audible.
So I think there's some issues in Sripana ma'am's internet. So anyways, she had given a brief about the program. And before we start, I'd like to give a brief on the session structures that we've planned for today's session. So initially, we'll start with about 10 minutes, wherein the panelists will introduce each other, giving them about 2 minutes each. Then we start another 15-minute session on the challenges and opportunities, where we'll see what are the opportunities for new entrepreneurs from the region, what are the specific areas for interventions, what are the role of rules and regulations, how much is compliance, and what changes are required. So we'll cover this around 15 minutes time. After that, there will be a short presentation by Chitra on the recent investment in the waste management sector. So we'll cover in around 3 to 4 minutes. Followed by some insights on the post-COVID scenario, where we are going to cover areas like how the landscape has changed, how regulation has changed post-COVID, and how will it impact human behavior. And this sort of discussion we'll do, that would be again in duration of 10 to 12 minutes. After that, we'll give an option for audience for a question and answer session. So audience can still put any questions in the chat box. So that is basically the structures in short. The moderator will take over once I cover the speakers. So today we have five distinguished speakers, including the moderator, Mr. Chitra Burgoyne. So I'm going to speak briefly on the profile of the speakers. We have Dr. Santanu Kumar Dutta, who is the additional director of the Central Pollution Control Board. Presently working as the additional director in the Central Pollution Control Board, he has gathered over 20 years of experience in industrial monitoring and waste management. Dr. Das is trained by Japan International Cooperation Agency, JICA, for environmental restoration of degraded lands. He is a person dedicated for the improvement of the environment. And interestingly, he has planted more than 5.25 lakhs of trees in industrial areas of Assam and Meghalaya. So welcome, Dr. Santanu Dutta. Secondly, we have Dr. Sanjay K. Gupta, who is the director of Care Northeast Foundation. Dr. Gupta has professional background as a social and environmental development specialist with 19 years of experience in waste management, recycling, livelihood, organic product promotion. He is a senior expert and advisor with SCAT Consulting Limited, Switzerland, director of NGO Care Northeast Foundation, and senior advisor with Swiss Red Cross, senior advisor and consultant for Swachh Bharat Assam, Government of Assam. Welcome, Dr. Gupta. Third, we have Mr. Partha Pratim Pathak, who is the owner of Fresh Air Waste Management Services Private Limited. Partha Pratim is the founder of the company, and his company owns and operates one of the 178 common biomedical waste treatment facilities in the country, which is one and only fully fledged common facility of its kind in the whole Northeast India. At present, the company is responsible for disposal of solid biomedical waste generated by healthcare facilities of Guwahati, Kamrup Metro, and rural Nogaon, Moriani, and Nalbari. Welcome, Mr. Pathak. Fourth, we have Dr. Amarjyoti Kashyap, who is the Chief Functionary of Environment. Dr. Kashyap is the President's Chief Functionary of Environment. Environment worked actively in the field of environmental management and sustainable development. Some of the technologies developed by Dr. Kashyap includes solid waste management practices like household plastic craft to utilize plastic waste at source, waste assimilators for the management of biodegradables and waste at source, and money earning litter bin for the source segregation of plastic waste, etc. He has been invited as an expert by the various organizations like Department of Administrative Reforms and Public Grievances, Government of India, Public Health Engineering Department, Government of Assam, Assam Science Society, etc. Very warm welcome, Dr. Kashyap. And finally, we have Achitra Borgohai, who is our moderator and speaker. And Achitra is the CEO of Binbag Recycling Services Private Limited. He's the founder and CEO of the organization. And Beanbag is addressing the problem of electronic waste, e-waste, by creating distributed mini recycling plants across India. It currently operates plants in Bangalore, Guwahati, and Mumbai. The Guwahati plant is the first e-waste recycling unit in the entire Northeast. Welcome, Achitra. And now I hand over to Achitra to moderate the session and take this forward. Thank you all.
Thank you, Anastas. So thank you for setting the context. And I thought since there is a wider audience, right, from students to entrepreneurs and people who were working in some corporates and are now looking to, you know, start up. So I thought I will quickly set the context in terms of why are we discussing waste management today. So I think waste management is not a new challenge. Waste has been generated since the beginning of civilization. And if you look back, Roman civilization had waste legislation at that point, in those days. But what has changed in the recent times is our relationship with the waste. We generate so many types of waste today and in such huge quantity that by 2050, we are expecting that there will be more plastic in the ocean than fishes. That's by weight, right? So when we are producing such huge quantity and so many different waste forms, it is very important that we start looking at what is it that we can do to keep this waste out of the landfills and out of the ocean. Now, when we talk about landfills, I mean, this is one of the largest waste landfill in the outskirts of Delhi, which is in Ghazipur, spread across 70 acres and 65 meters in height. That's just 8 meters short of Qutub Minar. So that is the kind of waste that we are generating and dumping it in the landfill. And I'm sure the panelists will touch upon the subject of how waste, when viewed as a resource, suddenly becomes a matter of livelihood and, you know, secondary resource generation and really helps in the circular economy. The situation is same. I mean, it's not just solid waste. The situation is same across all kinds of waste form. Electronic waste, where I work closely, globally we produce about 50 million tons, which is an equivalent of 6,000 Eiffel Towers. And less than 20% of it is being recycled and collected formally globally. And it's not just India. You would have read, people who are interested in this space must have read about articles how waste from the Western countries, how the waste from the US and Europe are being dumped in Africa, Ghana, India, China, and all those. Yeah. So it is with this background that we have set up today's agenda of, and these are the topics that we will quickly touch upon, which is the opportunities and challenges in the waste management sector. Of course, post March 2020, we cannot discuss anything today without discussing what has been the impact of COVID-19 on any sector, whether it is waste. I was attending a few other sessions, including IT, and even there we were talking how waste has, how COVID-19 has impacted even the IT sector. Of course, we have Dr. Shantanu, who is leading the Central Pollution Control Board in Shillong regional office. And we will get to know from him the regulatory aspects of, concerning the waste subject. So yeah, this is mostly, will be a conversational format with Q&A. I'll be asking a few questions to the panelists here. Then we will open it up for the audience. We're trying to keep it within the timeline of 60 minutes. Now that IIE has already introduced the panelists briefly, I think we will straightway skip to the key questions that we have. And our are the panelists, four panelists, all of you can hear me clearly?
Yes, yes, we are hearing.
Yes, yeah.
Okay, yes. Sure. So let me start with the topic of the season, I would say, which is biomedical waste, because COVID has really changed how. I am echoing myself here. Right now.
Yes, we heard your echo.
Okay. So let me start with Ms. Pathor. Mr. Parthar, you had been, you had started pressure about, I think, 2002-2003. So, I mean, and those were very early days of entrepreneurship when, you know, starting up was still not fashionable, I would say. So what made you, you know, tackle, what made you start up and then to look at a problem like biomedical waste? Because I understand you are an engineering graduate. So can you just tell us about your journey and what are the challenges that you faced during this time?
Thank you, Achitra. The thing is that in 2003, as you have said, the waste management itself is a new thing. Forget about biomedical waste. So I was lucky enough to I worked in an oil service company called Myron Injection in Mumbai, where I got to see the first common biomedical waste treatment facility in Mumbai. And also during my sixth semester environmental engineering project, I did a project called the handling of biomedical waste in a certain hospital. And so in fact, that grew some interest in those days. But when in the year 2003, when I have to come back home because of some of my own reasons, at the time that too, I got an opportunity to work in a hospital, which was an NRI project called Brahmaputra Hospital, and there I got to see the hospital activities, waste management activities there. In a very crude manner, and at that time the international hospital had an incinerator, and I proposed them, which eventually had become a white elephant because of the service lags and all. So I proposed them to give that incinerator to me as a on lease basis, and thereby started my business by collecting biomedical waste. And I was lucky enough to come across who is one of my senior present in the panel, Santanu Dutta. So I came across him, and he was the first person to give me the idea to go for a common biomedical, full-fledged common biomedical waste treatment facility. So the journey was not that easy, but I went to. Very briefly, I'd like to say that I went to several banks and financial institutions asking for money for such a project, but that couldn't be materialized. But again, NEPFI come forward, and my concept was very new at the time. So my first job was, or the hurdle was to convince them about my concept. So they got convinced, and they financed the required amount, and ultimately it started in 2004, and the journey is on.
Okay, excellent. If you can tell me what stage you are in today, just quickly, when you say since then.
Yeah.
How many hospitals you are serving?
Yeah. So metaphorically, I would like to say that. If you are driving a car, then I am in the fourth gear. If it has got a fifth gear, so
okay.
why I am saying, because right now I am providing service to 10,000 bed, 7,000 bed, 7,000 order on beds in Indus region, five districts including Guwahati.
Okay.
Why I am saying it is not in the top gear. Because there are 178 facilities or near about 200 facilities all over India. And if we can compare with such a big, having such a big facility, I'm able to give 7,000 bed, provide service to 7,000 bed, whereas my nearest facility, slightly smaller than mine, is providing service to 25,000 bed. So comparing to them, the financial implications, as far as financial implications are concerned, I'm still at the fourth year.
Very nice.
Okay. But still, I think you have covered a lot in the, and kudos to you. Yeah, so moving from biomedical to another hot topic right now, which is plastic, because suddenly, you know, because of the COVID, there also has been a talk that there will be a sudden increase in the use of single-use plastic. So I'll move to Dr. Ramajyoti here. Can you mute the all the attendants, please, host?
Hello, Asitra, yes.
Just one second. I am speaking with the host. Vijay. I hear a lot of talking at the background and there's somebody laughing, which is... Abhijit, can you mute everyone except for the four panelists? Yeah. So I'll come back to the question to Dr. Ramajyoti. So staying with a similar question, but what are the challenges that you saw when you started up Enviro in the focusing on the solid waste management? And how do you see the industry has changed in the last, say, 5 to 7 years that you had been in?
Well, Asitra, actually, thing is that entire solid waste management problems are created by the mixing of plastic waste along with the biodegradable waste. That is why I have observed that the plastic waste should be addressed separately and biodegradable waste should be addressed as a resource base. And accordingly, I have invented one waste assimilator through which we can convert all type of daily generated biodegradable waste to organic manure and biopest repellent. So that was my first intention to reduce the biodegradable waste and to source segregate the biodegradable waste from the plastic waste. Then I have observed that the plastic waste, most of the people are speaking about the plastic waste and simply the single-use plastic they mentioned as the some of the recyclable plastic. I have, in 2009, one of the, my research paper was awarded as the best research paper in first international conference on solid waste management organized by Jadavpur University, where I have, where I was the first person in, I think, that I have categorized the recyclable and non-recyclable plastics. So for your kind information and all of you, that the plastic carry bags, all type of plastic carry bags, even below 20 microns are recyclable. And the PET bottle, which are polyethylene terephthalates, are recyclable. But most of the Western countries and developed countries, they speak it as a single use. But my intention is to segregate the plastic waste for the beneficial product to produce some beneficial product and recycling and reuse. And now we are concentrating on source reduction of plastic waste by introducing plastic craft at household level, by producing different household decorative and usable items, as share bag, mattress, different plastic bags, different plastic base, etc. So accordingly, I observe, Asitra, that the Indian scenario and Western scenario is not same. And I observed particularly that most of the people of India, they used to speak the single-use as whatever the developed countries are speaking. Like the single-use plastic, they mostly named as the carry bags and plastic PET bottles are single-use. But I pathetically observed that these are used as a resource in India. Most of the recycling factories, they are doing their business by utilizing these carry bags and PET bottle. So it is our wrong approach that we are inserting different type of waste inside the plastic carry bags and we are now using plastic bags as a garbage bags. So I always observed, if we are going to ban on plastic carry bags, but garbage bags will remain. So once we are depositing all the waste, including biodegradable waste, inside the plastic carry bags, our problem will never be solved. And for your kind information, so far plastic carry bags is nowadays is a big concern for this. Most of the cities now are speaking that by 2022, by 2021, there will be the zero waste, zero plastic free. plastic free Mumbai will be going to be developed by simply ban on plastic carry bags. It is very laughing story, because if you consider the entire plastics, hardly 1% plastics is plastic carry bags, and mostly these are recyclable.
That plastic is by weight. When you say 1%, that is by weight.
That is by weight. And thing is that my intention is that ban on plastics is not a solution. Our solution should be on recycling. We should give major emphasis on plastic recycling, and also we should identify the non-recyclable plastics. For your kind information, all the multi-layered plastics.
I got your point. What we should do that is something that we will certainly touch upon as we go ahead.
Yes.
But
yes.
My specific question to you, just to give a context to everyone, that how your journey has been in the last, say, 5 years, and what are the challenges that you face, so that you know the people who are looking to start up or want to be entrepreneurs also get an idea that you know it's not all the smooth sailing. Like Partho has said, he's still in the fourth gear after 17, 18 years.
So
what are the kind of challenges?
I was also a teacher in the Department of Environmental Science. I resigned my job from 2000. Okay. One of my direct students, Kostov Kakoti, Biomedical Waste Management, and Fecal Sludge Management. He was my direct student in LCB College. Okay. So I resigned my job in 2008, and then I have worked with this my organization Environ. So especially we are working on solid waste management. Then I observed that the solid waste can be utilized as resource, and that is why I have innovated this waste assimilator to convert our daily generated biodegradable waste for producing organic manure and biopest repellent in the form of microbial wash, vermiwash, and finally vermicompost. That device waste assimilator is so simple that you can directly dispose all the daily generated biodegradable waste. Initially, microbial aerobic digestion is taking place. After that, earthworm assimilation is also taking place, and finally we are getting the vermicompost. But it is very beauty of the waste assimilator is that we are getting the benefit just after 2 days of use of that waste assimilator. We are getting this liquid nutrients that can be used as organic manure and biopest repellent. So that is the beauty of the organic waste management. And another thing is that the plastic waste management, as we are now practicing, it is very, I'm glad to inform you that our beneficiaries are now producing different garland, chair bag, table mat, table top, flower vase, water bottle bag, decorative bag, and different other decorative items, households and decorative items.
Yeah.
So they are producing waste
to value. You have been able to, capture the whole chain.
So in this way, we are managing both biodegradable waste and non-biodegradable waste.
Sure. So let me move to Dr. Shantanu now, and I want to get some flavor of the regulatory side, since we have heard two entrepreneurs. Mr. Shantanu, the question that I wanted to put forward to you is related to Swachh Bharat. So Swachh Bharat was like a war cry from our Honorable Prime Minister, to which brought cleanliness and hygiene to the focus of every Indian. So today, while my mom, my grandparents always used to clean their houses, but nobody used to talk it in the language of Swachh Bharat. So from a regulatory perspective, how has the regulations or from a regulatory aspect, how it has changed with what was pre Swachh Bharat and post Swachh Bharat? Can you give us some comparison of it as to how the pollution control boards and the regulatory bodies changed post Swachh Bharat?
Yes, definitely. I'm audible?
Yes.
Can you hear me? Yeah. I'll give the background. Soon after Modi government came in 2014, all the waste management rules was given a focus. That is the maybe journey of the Swachh Bharat, beginning of the Swachh Bharat. All the waste management rules were rewritten, in fact. Then in 2014, in 2016, we got 6 waste management rules. It covers e-waste rules separately, plastic waste rules separately, biomedical waste, solid waste management rules, But like that, there are six rules, six solid waste management rules, construction and demolition waste rules.
Okay.
Those rules came into the unregulated notification. And that journey of Swachh Bharat began there. Now with the Swachh Bharat mission, another regulatory aspects I'll
tell you. Okay, can I quickly interrupt one question? So, are you saying these rules were not there before Swachh Bharat, or it was not strictly implemented?
No, rules. For example, biomedical rule was initially promulgated in 1998 when Partho started the Common Biomedical Waste Management Facility. That was under biomedical waste rules 1998. Similarly, we had solid waste rules. We had even e-waste rule 2011. But soon after the government came, there's some task force were formed. Find out the effective, which rules are effective, which are not effective.
Mm-hmm.
So these rules, say solid waste management rules, because of the special focus from the PMO, was given lots of importance. And that is why in the same year, in March 2016, all the rules came. And with a clear direction to various stakeholders to implement the various provisions. But main problem is that, now I will give you an example. We have Swachh Bharat mission, we have separate directorate for Swachh Bharat mission. We are there in MOEF, we are in CPCB, we are in SPCB, State Pollution Control Board.
Yeah.
But still there is some gap. I have interacted with various officials of Swachh Bharat mission in various forums. Thing is that Swachh Bharat mission is working, lots of fund is there. There's just no fund problem is not at all there under Swachh Bharat mission.
Okay.
One of the main issue that provisions of the solid waste management rules, there are so many provisions.
Mm-hmm.
While framing the action plan under Swachh Bharat, the relevant clauses in the solid waste management rules not fully focused. It should go together because we are going with the solid waste management rules, which is a legislative gazette notification. We have to act on that line, but in practically there are some gaps. So we are trying to reduce that gap. We are telling that both the rules should go together. That even Swachh Bharat mission director should fully comply with the provisions of the rules. Then we can go faster.
Hmm.
Anyway, things are happening. We can see. And another issue I'll tell you regarding Common Biomedical Waste Rules 2016, Biomedical Waste Rule 2016, and Hazardous Waste Rule Management and Transboundary Movement 2016. These rules are framed citing that, with a clear guideline that every city now, that common that biomedical waste rules are there since 1998. So it is assumed that cities are having Common Biomedical Waste Management Facility. Or
if the critical word you are using is assume, because assumption is a word that you are using.
Yes, specific reason for that, when you go through the provisions of the rules, when you read the rule, you will see that example I'm giving you, biomedical waste or hazardous waste rules. They are telling the waste, biomedical waste generated in a city, it will be going to the Common Biomedical Waste Management Facility. Similarly, hazardous waste generated in a state or in a particular district will go to the Common TSDF, Transportation, Storage and Disposal Facility of Hazardous Waste. It is mentioned like that. That is why the assumption is now in the government of India level, that rules are framed thinking that every state, every city having a common biomedical waste management rule facility. Now, for example, for Guwahati, we don't have any problem. We don't have any issue regarding management of biomedical waste because of Partho's presence. But this is the only facility in the Northeastern region. And the rules say, even after that COVID situation, Central Pollution Control Board has made three sets of guidelines. 1, 2, 3. It is regularly updated. And it is telling mostly that COVID waste should go to the common facility, Common Biomedical Waste Management Facility. And lastly, it is given if the facility is not there, common facility is not there, it should be go into deep burial. that is permitted. But the tragedy is that we do not have any facility other than Guwahati in entire Assam. Now problem is there, we do not know how exactly it is treated in, say in Bongaigaon, so many cases. We are not knowing. In Kasar, there is no facility.
Dibrugarh has a huge hospital base, I understand. They don't have any common biomedical facility.
Dibrugarh Medical College is operating an incinerator. It is okay. taking the waste from the nearby hospitals. But officially, mm-hmm. it is not declared as a common facility. We are writing to the Pollution Control Board
okay.
that common facilities should have online monitoring facilities also, which can be we can read from here that emission parameters. So okay. these facilities are not there. Similarly, Jorhat also having some municipal board were doing some facilities, but it's not the proper common biomedical waste management facility. In record, it is not there. So today itself in the morning, we have written to the State Pollution Control Board, just write to us how waste are managed in Jorhat or Dibrugarh.
Uh-huh.
Similarly, that TSDF, this is a, we are having problem. In Northeast, we are having the problem of hazardous waste management.
Right.
We do not have any common TSDF, but rules are telling it should go to the TSDF. It is happening like that. That's why I'm telling it is in central level. It is assumed that already these facilities have come up. But in fact,
okay.
we are lagging behind a lot.
You actually gave out already, I could see three opportunities for entrepreneurs, which I will come in the next question to
yes.
you. But during the challenges that you are facing, you already gave out three opportunities because every challenge brings an opportunity for an entrepreneur to work upon. Right. So, yeah, thank you.
Yeah.
I'll just come back to you on the opportunity
yes,
side
yes.
because now suddenly I have more questions to you for the opportunity.
Yes.
So, Sanjay, I would like to bring you in. And since you have worked abroad and your flight, I assume, just landed in India. That's why I brought you in late for the conversation. So since you work in Switzerland and so many other countries, right? So I want you to give a perspective of what is it that you see is different in India, right? And vis-a-vis a country like Switzerland, Sweden, which are almost, 90% compliance, if not 100%, right? So what has been your learning working abroad and how is it different in India?
Thanks everybody. Thanks, Dr. Santanu. Let me carry forward from where Dr. Santanu has left. We assume that a lot of things are there, whether it is in the rules or in the practicality. And we also ignore the fact that the ecosystem that a developed country has is often lacking in countries like India. So it will be foolish to compare oranges with apples. But I would just juxtapose both the Swiss or the European standards with that of to similar where the Latin American and the Indian or Asian conditions. Probably that will give us a idea that where we are lacking. So as Dr. Santanu said, we assume that a lot of things are happening or the systems are in place by which whether it is municipal waste or biomedical waste or hazardous waste will be taken care of. For example, as I speak today, in Tinsukia, the entire biomedical waste from the government facilities and the ad hoc quarantine facilities end up with the municipal waste in the municipal dump site situated near Edni River. So those systems are never in place. India has one of the finest laws, I would say. I have studied around 52, 53 countries, municipal solid waste, biomedical waste rules. And I would say that India has a fairly very good regulations, but the enforcement is simply not there. For example, until I came to Tinsukia, there was no door-to-door collection, there was no segregation, no composting. So in similar ways, the government assumes too many things, which on the ground, it doesn't happen. One thing that we see in the developed countries is a very strict enforcement of law. So if I mix my waste in my house in Switzerland, I pay 200 Swiss francs, which is around 14,000 rupees for the first violation. If I repeat, then it might go to 300, 500, and then eventually stricter and stricter penalties. The same story you would see it in Sweden, you will see it in Singapore. So all the countries, I can give you a name of 10 cities, the 10 top cleanest cities that manage their waste as per the rules. The thumb rule is not whether you have the technology, not that you have human resources, not that you have technical know-how. The thumb rule is enforcement of those rules to everybody. So here, if we enforce it to the public, we are not enforcing it to the guy who is at the helm of affairs in the municipality. So the public might get penalized for littering, but the junior engineer who is in charge of to see that door-to-door collection takes place, composting takes place, he doesn't get penalized. So if and just to say in a very lighter way, if the pollution control board, Assam Pollution Control Board, doesn't do a good job of monitoring, it doesn't get penalized. Neither does the pollution control board penalize.
Now you are rubbing it the wrong way.
This is what the big difference is.
I take your point that enforcement is lacking, and that's where, you know, something. But that also brings me to the other side, that, you know, it's also human behavior, right? You can only police to a certain degree. Taking the example of COVID, Sweden never went into lockdown, but they gave out the rules and regulations to the people, and they believed that the people will follow that, and they have fairly eradicated or controlled COVID in Sweden. So I think, yeah, I get your point. Enforcement is required, but it's also human behavior of how we are as Indians, and I think that human behavior component is something that really needs a discussion, and we'll touch it very soon. But so what has been your learning, or let me put it, rephrase it, what is it that you think can be, you know, implemented in India, what you have learned abroad?
I mean, one thing that we certainly have to work is on what I call the waste governance deficit, by which means, okay, if there are rules that have the conditions of those rules have to be fulfilled. If the government says, or the rule says, the door-to-door collection has to take place, it has to take place. If segregation has to take place, it has to. So one of the key thing is that developing an ecosystem whereby which we can remove the deficit that is there in the governance. For example, one of the participants here is Dr. Nanji Chaudhary. He's ready to provide a machine free of cost for doing a composting. So we can manage 500 kgs of compost, by which directly means I will be able to manage 180 tons of waste in a year by the machine that he supplies. The municipality and the district administration is not allowing a small space of 20 by 20 to set up that. So these are the small challenges. One single letter to be sent to the funding agency which is ready to set it up in Tinsukia. So I've been running in around for 6 months for getting the letter, getting a land identified, but none of these things actually materialize. So unless we remove these deficits in governance, particularly in the waste governance at the municipal level, it is not going to happen so soon. I'm implementing three projects in smaller towns, Tinsukia, Dunduma, and Titabar. Titabar has turned out to be a very, very good one because of a very good chairman and a very good STO. So that's the difference between individual commissioners, chairperson also brings in the fact.
So you were saying it is, while there are laws, the enforcement is lacking, and secondly, the governance of the laws. And it is sometimes individual driven, that the person who really wants to drive it is actually driving it, and it's not throughout the state or the country, right?
Yeah,
sure. Okay, so I'll bring in Partha again to the discussion. And now I just want to move from the challenges, because every challenge throws an opportunity for, the entrepreneurs. So Partha, if you can, you know, tell us, since you have been there for last now almost 17 years, what are the gaps that you see in the biomedical space? Of course, you said Santunda, in fact, actually brought in a lot more opportunities, and I'll go back to him. But what within the biomedical space, what are the opportunities that you see for people who are interested to look at biomedical?
Yeah, as far as opportunities is concerned, in the field of biomedical waste management.
Sure.
People can think about two sectors. One is service in the form of collection, transportation, treatment, and disposal.
Okay.
So that is always on. And the second thing.
Okay. Can you put this in the perspective of the fact that you were mentioning when we were talking day before yesterday that one biomedical facility
right.
within one center. So please put right. that in perspective right. so that people understand.
Yeah. I in fact initially started talking about the solid waste management as a whole. Okay, as far as biomedical waste is concerned,
biomedical.
Yeah. Right. Then as Shantanu Dutta will be saying the same, that you have got a common biomedical waste, a certain common biomedical waste treatment facility is capable of giving service up to 150 kilometer.
So kilometers.
Yeah. And they have also given a cap of 10,000 bed. But in the recent guidelines, it has been seen that it has been challenged in different places like Bhopal and all, where facilities are providing service more than 10,000 beds, say 20,000. In fact, in Kerala, there is only one common biomedical waste treatment facility, very big facility, and they are providing service to 40,000 beds. So there is a certain limit where it is, as far as the perspective of Assam is concerned or Northeast is concerned, then looking at the topography of Assam, 150 is a good parameter you can rely upon. And Dibrugarh is a place where it has got connectivity with Lakhimpur and all. So where full-fledged facility of good capacity can cater the whole almost 50% of the Upper Assam area, and a facility in the Tejpur or Koliabor or maybe in Jorhat can cater the whole area nearby. We will be needing a facility at Borak Valley also. Somewhere in Bongaigaon, but ultimately one thing which will come into play at the end of the day, how much money you are earning, whether it is viable or not.
Sure.
See, sure. These rules are there right from 1998, and the common concept of common biomedical waste treatment facility came in the through an amendment at year 2000 and 2003. So I got the opportunity and I took the opportunity, but it was not as easy as I have said, because there is a certain business community with due respect, I'm saying, they could have taken this opportunity much before I did. Because why they didn't come up? Because of the viability of the thing.
Project. Okay.
Yeah. So okay. This is the service tech sector I have talked about, and as far as the sales are concerned, then in sales there are ample of opportunities. Like there are machines, people can supply machines, people can think of supplying consumables, and it is not all about just collecting the biomedical waste and incinerating. There is a number of you are also into waste management, you know that. So machines can be from the conventional machines to innovative one. Yeah. So, and the innovatives will give you good money.
Okay.
And the bottom line is that, again, I'll have to say that in the field of waste management, which is not there in maybe in the other field, the thing is that you have to bring a concept, be it in service or in sales. You have to bring a concept into people, and you have to convince your clients with that concept. So if you are able to sell your concept, then in waste management it will do good. But the concept should be a feasible one. you cannot go and sell every concept which doesn't work. It will last for hardly 2-3 years. But if you are selling a concept which will really work, then definitely it will bring good business in it. Okay. So wind it up. Yeah. So again, in the field of waste management, what I have seen, if somebody in the field of sales of machines or technology, if somebody comes up, what we directly face a problem in biomedical waste management is segregation. And our machineries are based on the technology of segregation only. The incinerator should not or cannot dispose plastics or other materials apart from incinerable waste. So which means that the segregation has to be perfect. And if you don't have segregated well, then ultimately our incinerators are connected to online monitoring system. And in the coming time, our online monitoring system will be giving parameters of dioxins and furans, which are carcinogenic in nature. So if segregation is not proper, then CPCB and PCB will get hold of us. So ultimately, what I'm saying.
So at this thought, let me quickly go to CPCB because I wanted to get into speak to something, especially on since it brought out actually the opportunity side also, especially focusing on biomedical. And you talked about the online monitoring, which also Sansunda said, and there was a mention about the PSDF. So Sansunda, my question to you is, where do you see an opportunity for an entrepreneur to come in any of this, which is, Partho was saying about setting up new biomedical facilities, but is it viable or is there a pollution control board looking at some kind of a viability gap funding? And in terms of online monitoring, is there an opportunity for entrepreneurs to work on collecting data, right? Because data somehow in India is almost not there. Whether it is, I can speak of e-waste, I can speak of other kinds of waste, because data has been a big issue in India. We really don't know how much we generate and how much is going to the landfill. So what are those kind of scopes that you see in terms of a surveillance? I remember you showing me some pictures of non-compliance in our March meeting where companies are dumping the waste. Is there an opportunity for, let's say, remote surveillance using drones? What kind of opportunity do you see for an entrepreneur here?
Yeah. I'll cover 2-3 things. First, I'd like to tell Mr. Gupta regarding the facilities trying to make up, build up in Tinsukia. Now, as per the order of Honorable MGT, in some cases, district level environmental management plan, DEM, it is being framed where active participation of district administrator, district magistrate is required. And he is held accountable by the NGT. DM from all the districts will come, then it will be compiled to make a state environmental management plan, and finally that country environmental management plan will be covered. So it is the duty of the active duty of the public district magistrate to help him to get that land as he is coming up, and he can incorporate this aspect in his district environmental management plan. I am also working on this. I was thinking, I am given the assignment of making the DEM for a particular district in Assam. I was thinking of Kamrup, but now I'm thinking I'll go to Tinsukia and we can make together a very good district environmental management plan, incorporating all this where district magistrate must help. He's held accountable. Accountability aspects also, Mr. Gupta was telling. Now officers of SPCB, Central Pollution Control Board, they are accountable to NGT. They are giving, writing this type of report, this type of question is coming, and it is being fined also. In many cases, if you are not fail to give the report within the time, you are fined, say, rupees 20,000-50,000 or so, like that. That is one part. So I'll definitely work together with Mr. Gupta. Let us do something in Tinsukia. Good initiative. I'll help you.
Excellent.
What I can. Regarding the regarding the biomedical waste again. A few days back, I wrote to.
I'm not saying the only biomedical, but overall, what kind of opportunities that you see?
Yeah, I'll tell in a faster way, and I'll try to cover the issue. I wrote personally to Mr. Himanta Biswa Sarma, Dr. Himanta Biswa Sarma. We know personally also that everybody, every person from Assam is saluting you for your effort for COVID control.
Right.
But you should focus on the COVID waste management also, because only facilities available in Assam. In Guwahati, and from it is difficult to carry the waste from Bongaigaon or from Tinsukia or from Jorhat. So later on in the, I wrote to him, and later on his subsequent press conference, he was telling that facility where we are not, where it is not there, common facility, we are going for that deep burial. But that is the last option.
Last option.
We have told them also. So that scope for the common facility or at least common biomedical waste incinerator is definitely there in various parts of Assam. Partho has already told about Borak Valley. We need one Dibrugarh site like that. Even in, I heard that Moran also somebody is trying so to cater with Sipsagar and Dibrugarh district like that. But we need now one of the for biomedical waste also that that district magistrate has to help in finding out the space. He has to allot the land for this facility. These types of assignments are, these types of accountability is given to the district magistrate. But our main problem is the coordination amongst the EA, and for the district magistrate, the focus given to the waste management is the least amongst his so many other duties. That is one main problem. But now we can approach them easily. That is the NGT's backup. Everybody is held accountable. So nowadays we can talk to the DC. Obviously, district that to discuss about these issues. So that is the things coming. Regarding, I will touch upon the e-waste also. E-waste, it is in my office itself. Yesterday also we discussed. We are trying to get the waste accumulate or waste collected together so that we can send to your facility. Okay. That is the only facility so far in Assam or Northeast, you can say. So.
Yeah.
You have to, but we can also send, but you have to collect it. That will be better for us. Maybe that is that like us, there will be so many government departments who will like to give the waste to a facility register. Nowadays, it is going to the informal sector. But when we get a formal sector registered one, we are all the departments are definitely going to send the waste there. Maybe it's free of cost. Maybe it's free of cost also. Another thing that, like our last meeting, we are discussing regarding the co-incineration of waste for waste management. We are finding lots of difficulties. I have been requested by Sun Pharma, Guwahati, that one Palasbari one Sun Pharma is there. So they want to send the waste to Dalmia, Umrangsu for co-incineration.
Okay.
But lots of difficulties they faced the moment they started. People, they made an agreement with the Dalmia Cement Umrangsu, but local people came and they are obstructing the movement of the waste. And it is my experience with many industries, it is very difficult to take out the waste from an industry to another place without the interference of the local people. So that how we can interfere, the problem we are still facing. But we have to talk to the local police station that they have to facilitate the journey of the waste from the occupier station to the common treatment facility. Like this also we have to work out. We are facing some problem in this issue.
Okay.
And regarding that dissemination of data, now see that common facility at Partho's common facility, it is connected with monitoring facility, online continuous monitoring facility with regard to various gaseous pollutants, even dioxin freons also it is coming. So these data, even in our mobile, we can see it. There is a service provider that data may be made available to the public, and in our website, ambient air quality data, it is easily available to the public. Regarding particular types of data of waste generation, suppose what is the e-waste generation, that data is not is available in the report form. No, not online data is available, because that data we have to get from State Pollution Control Board, say biomedical waste, say US, they are filing return. We are compiling the data and it is available in the report form. This definitely it can be made available to the public on request.
Okay. No, I was saying if there was an some kind of online tool or mechanism that somebody with a good IT knowledge can make, where the flow of information from, say, my plant to PCB to Central Pollution Control Board becomes so seamless that I don't have to keep filling up. So, like, we fill a Form 6. That Form 6, if it is directly visible to, say, Pollution Control Board Assam, and then from Pollution Control Board Assam, CPCB has that knowledge. So even that kind of seamless data flow also, it would have been much, would have made life easier for all the stakeholders in the chain, because every time we compile a Form 6, we give it to Pollution Control Board Assam, they in turn report to you. So I think a lot of offline, if can be made online, could be an opportunity also, is what I feel. Anyway, I get your point. So, I will come to you regarding a very similar question about what are the opportunities that you see in the solid waste management now that you have seen and been there for a long time. Waste to value is something that you are already doing. But say an entrepreneur in the Northeast wants to start something in the solid waste management space. So what are the opportunities that you see for a young entrepreneur?
So thing is that Partha has rightly pointed out the good concept, viable concept and innovation. So these are necessary for the solid waste business. So for your kind information, I would like to convey the information to all the viewers that due to the innovation that I have received the Millennium Alliance Innovation Award Round 4. It is a national program, it was, and Millennium Alliance is the biggest platform in the innovation sector. So I was the only one out of 100 innovation in India that received this Millennium Alliance Innovation Award in water and sanitation segment. Then also I awarded as the top out of the top 5 innovators of India, the Mahatma Gandhi International Sanitation Convention. My innovation was the among the top innovation, top five innovation. Then also I received the 3-year excellence award from Ministry of Housing and Urban Affairs. Then also recently I have received this Krishna Kanta Handik Open University National Fellowships. These are required for the building of the confidence among our entrepreneurs so that our resource, we can utilize our solid waste as resource and convert a biodegradable solid waste to organic manure and biopest repellent, and plastic waste as a different type of resource-based product and for recycling base. And for your kind of information, this COVID-19, these cases, I am glad to inform you that recently Kamrup Metro District has collected 94 numbers domestic waste assimilator from us for the management of the post-COVID, this biodegradable waste management is at the quarantine camp. Because all the biodegradable waste generated in the quarantine camps are contaminated. So contaminated waste should be managed at source. And the beauty of the waste assimilator is that you no need to take any headache or any effort from yourself. You simply use and throw the food waste that generated from the quarantine camp, and it can be used after 6 months as a compost for this developing the garden.
Okay.
So this concept and I have developed from my innovation, and I would like to request all of my friends that our waste can be converted as resource, but due to the proper applicable concept and this innovative practice. From my households, I would like to spread the message that in this COVID-19 lockdown period, I am and my friends who has taken this domestic waste assimilator and practicing kitchen gardening, we are now not facing any problems of vegetables during this lockdown periods. We are in my rooftop organic vegetable garden. I am taking at least 10 to 11 numbers of vegetables from my own kitchen garden. So it is happening in most of my friends. They are also practicing the same practice. And so if we practice from our household to the real peoples, then only it can be happen in the real sense that our waste can be utilized as a resource. And the whole world is now concerned on organic farming. If you consider the entire world farmland, only 1.4% is cultivated organic. So there is a big prospect of organic farming. So waste is available, biodegradable waste is available in every places. Now I'm practicing and now I developed the concept of use of the all the daily generated biodegradable waste, including herbs, sharps, all the aquatic waste, all can be converted to this organic manure and biopest repellent.
Okay, so coming to the opportunity part, which I was saying, so because you have been an innovator and have developed so many, you know, assimilators and other tools, my question would be, let's say, more pinpointed, that if some entrepreneur wants to come and use one of those assimilators and start his or her own business, and instead of, you know, starting from zero or reinventing the wheel, would you be able are you willing to work with them?
Of course, I am really, I am appreciating, and I'm doing practically, we are working with some of the rural areas, so that they are now getting the practice of organic farming. So it is,
not just organic farming, like the assimilator that you said was used by the COVID-19.
Yes.
The same. So you are willing to partner with somebody, some entrepreneur who wants to take it to the remote cities.
So of course, most welcome.
Sanjay, you have any question to this thing? Because I was just coming to you for a question.
Just to add to what Amarjyoti said. See, there are three critical verticals or value chains where the prospect of entrepreneurship is very clear in my experience of the three municipalities. One is door-to-door collection. Every 250 to 300 household will give you one job. So in Tinsukia, overnight we created 110 jobs. The second is what Amarjyoti is saying, organic waste composter. Okay. So the waste assimilator can actually be as an independent enterprise, taking the free organic input, which is going to the dump site now, turning it to compost and going for the organic farming, which is picking up very quickly in Northeast.
I am actually thinking that Mr. Sanjay, I am always opposed the community waste management. I am against the door-to-door collection of biodegradable waste. I am always observed that once you collecting the biodegradable waste, there is every chances is there the mixing of plastic waste. So my entire intention is to decentralize waste management and organic farming. So every household can manage their biodegradable waste. At least 80 to 70% people can manage their biodegradable waste at their source. And as the waste assimilator is taking a very little space, only 1.5 feet areas is necessary. And every household, so far my knowledge is concerned, they are at least they are practicing this flower gardening. In every household, it is the practices there. So that also the nutrients is required. So in this case,
when you say flower gardening, it is individual houses can, but people can, in the apartment complexes and
but I always, because, Sanjay is concentrating on door-to-door collection of waste, but I was also concentrating in door-to-door collection of biodegradable and non-biodegradable in Guwahati city in the year of 2008. Then I have observed that there is a huge risk of the this mixing of the waste,
getting mixed up.
Yes.
Sanjay, you want to complete your thoughts on what are the value chain, within the value chain?
So one opportunity is in engaging for door-to-door collection.
Yes.
So every 100,000 population will create 100 jobs. This is as simple as that. The second is the organic fraction. So he may not like the door-to-door collection, but it is a mandatory activity under the law that door-to-door collection has to be there. And there will be plenty of households which will not be available or will not be willing to go for home composting kind of thing. So all that waste goes to an independent entrepreneur who using whatever technology he likes and supplies the organic manure to the organic farmers, for which there is plenty of demand now. For example, currently I have a 1-ton demand per month and I'm not able to do it. So I'm looking for somebody, local entrepreneur, who can take it up as an independent activity where I supply the organic input for free of cost. The third is the plastic part. Okay. And along with plastic, paper, glass, metals.
basically
be a organized scrap dealer which manages the waste more scientifically than it is done with the rudimentary technology and the informal way that it is the practice. And I do see coming from the developed countries that it's a good business. It's a good business. It may not generate kind of profit that IT industry generates, but it still creates a lots of jobs. For example, every ton of waste can generate one job, but every ton of waste being disposed in a landfill will create one job.
So I think the all the four panelists have very nicely put the opportunity, landscape for all the entrepreneurs, right from where the interventions could be and where the new entrepreneur can look at. So what I wanted to do was quickly put those opportunity in the number context. So that we are not just talking there is a huge opportunity, but just a quick putting the things into perspective, and I'll just take 2 minutes. So these are the two largest waste management companies globally. And Sanjay, you might be already knowing about WM, Republic Services. The reason I put this slide up front to the entrepreneurs is to show you that, when even by managing somebody's garbage, you can be a $40 billion market cap company, right? So you please look up WM or Republic Services and look at their revenues are close to $20 billion, okay? And the market cap of WM is $40 billion. So garbage is gold. Garbage is the new gold. So please look at this as an opportunity that is out there. And not just globally, even in India, I'm just touching on some of the large investments that I am aware of. Like Ramki had an $510 million investment from the largest private equity in the world, KKR. Let's Recycle is an Ahmedabad-based company where Avishkar and Asha Impact had made a 44 crores of investment. They handle only dry waste. And there's a Lucro based out of Mumbai where Circulate Capital has recently made an investment somewhere between 2 to 3 million, but exact figure has not come out. Right. So when we are talking about opportunity, especially to the wannabe entrepreneurs, please understand that we are not talking out of the air or trying to build castles in the air. Right. There are real opportunities out there, and you just have to find where you want to play your game and where you want to be good at, right? So there are people like Amarjyoti Das, Antonu Das, and I think all four of them have actually told you directly or indirectly that they see an opportunity and they'll be willing to work with the entrepreneurs to see them scale and see them that you succeed. You have seen Parthas starting way back in 2002, 2003 when Antonu Das had actually been a great support to him. So I think I will now quickly come back to what is the hot topic, and I already see a few questions on the chat. The post-COVID world, right? So this is not going to be the same like pre-COVID. And then my question is will be more or less same to all the four panelists, except maybe to Santanuda. Maybe I'll twist the question and maybe start with you. How has the regulation changed pre-COVID and post-COVID? Because I saw and read some some regulations, CPCB has come out with some regulations to deal with post-COVID waste. But to all the other three entrepreneurs here, Amarjyoti Das, Sanjay, Partha, what is post-COVID waste management going to look like? Right. So,
Santanuda,
I will start with you.
Our main focus was to deal with the waste. So, as I already told you, that there are three sets of guidelines. It was revised. Third guideline is in force now. So, it was the main focus, how the waste will go. Because that so much of, passability, we cannot pass the way, as the people even, person even suffering from COVID. So the waste generated from the COVID world, how it will be dealt with. So our main focus was immediately sitting with the Minister of Environment and Forest, these guidelines was regularly revised, and main focus was given for the incineration, definitely. And suppose incineration facility is not there, it is hardly there in the Northeast.
Right.
Very few hospitals they are having that one, only captive facilities. For example, in Shillong, we have asked NEGRIMS to use their facility for incineration, because that common facility with being operated by the Shillong Municipal Board is not working. And it is not possible. At the moment, suppose sending the waste from Barak Valley to Brahmaputra Valley is not possible, or from Bangaigaon to Guwahati also not possible. So last option was given for the deep burial.
Okay.
That is the last option again, but that option available.
Right.
That is the main focus in the post-COVID scenario for the waste management. It's a biomedical waste. For the other waste, for other online monitoring facilities, because of the most facilities are under shutdown. So these were not the major issues. The major issue was how to deal with this facility.
Okay, sure. So three other panelists. 2 minutes so, each. Asitra, we are already at 15:22.
Yes, yes.
We want to end this by 15:30 before we open up the Q&A. So, yeah, Omojit, please go ahead and tell us how will the post-COVID waste management sector look like?
Post-COVID waste management should be so far biodegradable waste management is concerned. It should be a quarantine waste management activity, just like, because the thing is that now if you consider the Guwahati city itself, the municipal workers, right, they are hesitant to collect the biodegradable waste. All the microbes, sure, including virus, can breed in the through the biodegradable waste. These are the media. So our concentration, I request Santanu Dutta to raise this issue that the biodegradable waste management, wherever it is possible, it should be managed at source, so that our waste handler, they should not get in contact with this contaminated waste, and which can be a very dangerous near future. So it should be, at least it should be managed at source through that I have invented this waste assimilator is maybe the one of the tool for this management of biodegradable waste. Okay. And also the non-biodegradable waste, the people should hand over the non-biodegradable waste after 24 hours or 48 hours after they keep in their home, then only they should transfer to the waste handler, so that the time period of the viral this existence should be come up. So accordingly, our waste handling management should rule and regulation should be modified accordingly as per the need. Thank you.
Partho?
Yeah, Chetra, I'd like to add a few things very briefly post-COVID.
Yeah.
Not only in the field of waste management for the newcomers and already who are in the business. See, I'm a part of few organizations and groups where directly related to the industries. Am I audible?
Okay.
Yeah.
Yes,
so, first of all, I would like to tell you the people who are interested in manufacturing, setting up small manufacturing units, it's time to be get ready to go for those small manufacturing industries under MSME, wherever you want to register, to make PPEs. It's a big business coming up. See, I tell you, pre-COVID situation, India hardly had a capacity of manufacturing PPEs. But now India manufactures about 2 lakhs PPEs per week, which is, and that demand is going to grow. So PPE in the form of the whole coverall or maybe gloves and mask, and those are not rocket technologies. And we are already getting supplies of it. I myself, consumption in a unit like mine, my consumption, it has jumped from November. It was not even 3,000 rupees per month. And now it has jumped today up to 45,000. This particular month, yes, 45,000. So I think people should rather take a note of it. Then comes again manufacturing. If somebody is thinking about manufacturing something in post-COVID situation, then the sanitizers, They can think about sanitizers. And the sanitizer is not a rocket technology thing, because 70% is nothing but alcohol. So my facility,
there are a lot of alcohol shops in Assam, at least.
Exactly. I tell you, my facility is located at Panikhati, and there is another industry which has come up 1 year back, and it got affected by flood last year. And we were thinking that all their efforts has gone in vain. But this COVID situation has brought good luck for them. So their whole facility was closed, the whole factory was closed, and now they have started producing sanitizer, and it was a liquor factory.
Oh, excellent.
So these two opportunities are there. Then small things which can be used. See, I have got a friend who used to make signboards and flag, made of flags and this thing, sunboards. So now they don't have any business because the advertisement has gone. So now they have started making this thing, disinfection tunnels.
Gotcha.
Have you seen that disinfection tunnels?
No,
it's a tunnel of say 5 feet or 6 feet or maybe 8 feet long, mm-hmm. where sanitizers or sodium hypochlorite solution in a very less quantity will be spread, and the person will be allowed to go inside. See, once the economic activities, once it gets started, these big bazaars and other mall will be opening, and they are already giving the requirement of this disinfection tunnels.
Exactly. I think these are the real entrepreneurs who, you know, pivoted from alcohol to sanitizer.
Yes.
Yeah, I think that's what the entrepreneurs.
There is going to be immense opportunities for this particular. Sure. Remember, PPEs, gloves and masks can be made at home only. And PPEs, plastic PPEs and sanitizers. And disinfection tunnels.
Sure.
And
so last 2 minutes, I'll go to Sanjay quickly. Sanjay, how do you think the sector is going to look like post-COVID before we open up a Q&A?
Partha has really given the flow chart of the jobs that will come up, or the entrepreneurship scope that will come up. Let me touch on the soft part of it. One, I see both biomedical waste management and municipal waste management moving from essential services to the critical services. So it will be one step ahead in priority. It will become a critical service. Second, the treatment of both biomedical and essential kind of going to become mandatory. It's no more you do it or don't do it. You will have to do it. So that will generate a lot of scope for businesses.
Sure.
The third is going to be on occupational safety. It's no more business as usual. So it will generate a lot of businesses where you will be required to wear your PPP, and then only you can do the job. So that's the third rung that will bring in the businesses for them. And then I guess there is going to be a lot of serious emphasis on biomedical waste management post-COVID. Rather, currently it has already started happening as Partha said, but it will be much more stringent. And I guess Dr. Santanu will confirm the monitoring part of also it's going to be enforced more seriously than it is. So that's how I see the post-COVID, the scope for entrepreneurship and the regulations that will gradually go on to creating those enabling conditions.
Yeah. Very, very nicely summed up. Thank you. Thank you, everyone. So I'll just open up the Q&A. Abhijit, you are there?
There are a lot of questions Abhijit? Already on the chat box, so if you want to have a look at that.
Yeah, but if I start reading it and...
Hello.
Abhijit, Neeraj, can you hear me? Neeraj?
Yes, it's audible.
Yeah, so, Neeraj, if you have noted down the questions, and
sure.
If
so
it is pinpointed to any particular panelist, yes, please name him and ask sure. the question. Yeah?
Sure.
I'm just doing the listening part right now.
Sure. Over to you. Thank you so much, Chitra. So to begin with the first question, I mean, like there are a couple of generic questions, but I will be just, you know, mentioning those questions which I have specifically mentioned for the speakers. So the first question is for Partha. And the question that has been put up is waste management has a financial sustainable business model? So primarily, does waste management has a financial, you know, sustainable business?
Yeah.
So for Partha.
Yeah. Thank you. Waste management, as far as the financial viability is concerned, it depends what is the model you are going to do. If it is a biomedical waste management, if you are going for a common biomedical waste treatment facility, that is the calculation is very simple. How much bed you are going to provide service? So there is a certain rate where you have to collect it from your clients, and depending on that you can calculate what will be your income and what will be the total revenue and whether it will be viable or not. As far as the rest of waste are concerned, municipal solid waste or TSDF, hazardous waste is concerned, I think for municipal solid waste, the other speakers will be able to tell you what is the viability of those waste management system. But as far as my, I just want to add one single thing that as of now, in the sector of biomedical waste, application software application, sale of software application has a new, it's a new thing which has got a future, because in 2003 it was a distant dream. Even you cannot dream also having a software application in waste management, but now there we are having barcode system, we are having online facility, we are having a hell of a lot of systems, and for that different in a span of maybe 1 year, I have seen more than 100 software suppliers, application suppliers in different. So this side, this aspect, looking into this aspect, the application and softwares, it's a very promising sector, you can say, in any kind of waste management. Especially I can tell you in the biomedical, because in biomedical waste management I have seen barcoding has started and it is going on very well. So again, CPCP has come up with a new COVID software, but that has been also taken up by all our facilities. So that is one of the promising sector, I should say. But as far as common biomedical waste treatment facility is concerned, you will need good amount of capital investment, and you have to be very calculative on it, how much revenue you are going to generate and what will be the viability. Thank you.
Right. Thank you, Partha. So yeah, so I hope that addresses the question which was put forth. Moving on, so this question is specifically addressed to Mr. Amarjyoti Kashyap. Sir, the question is, will the 2 to 3 days of Lishate will have the same level of nutrient level as the matured vermicompost?
Please repeat.
So the question is, will the 2 to 3 days Lishate will have the same level of nutrient level as a matured vermicompost? Mm-hmm. If one wants to use it for commercial purpose, from how many days of composting the lishate should be collected? So I'm really not so sure about the word lishate.
Lishate.
So that's the question.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So this lishate is the this innovation, this waste assimilator. Lishate is coming out. It's an organic microbial wash and vermi wash. It is a lishate of this biodegradable waste. So lishate can be utilized as the organic manure and biopass repellent, because it contains both the nitrogen, phosphorus and potash. These are the macronutrients, and different hormones, enzymes and amino acids also present as a micronutrients. So accordingly, it can be utilized as the both organic manure and biopest repellent, and finally vermicompost. So once the entrepreneur, particularly, he should either he should concentrate for this agricultural waste management or his household management. Now I am concentrating decentralized household management, as Mr. Sanjay Gupta is concentrating for community waste management. For community waste management, there are so many composter machines are there, but challenge is that the segregation. So my always I am pointing out that the source segregation and source management is very much easier than the community waste management. So our intention is to manage our biodegradable waste, and farmer in my different project, if you go to see, and there are so many projects are going on from our environment in Chandrapur areas, this Kajali Shoki, Tatimara village and Panbari village. Now I have introduced the biodegradable solid waste management and organic domestic organic green gardening. So in my Guwahati residence itself, I have started my, and though I am residing in Guwahati city, I am always used to speak that the, this entrepreneurship comes from my own activities, my own practice. So I have started my own entrepreneurship from my household itself. So now I am producing both organic green tea, both household vegetables and organic manure and biopest repellent, and finally vermicompost from my daily generated household waste. So accordingly, one entrepreneur can also look into it, and the farmers, they can practice by utilizing their biodegradable waste itself. And from the daily generated plastic waste, now our beneficiary households, particularly housewives, they are now practicing different plastic craft. They are producing different plastic products from the daily generated plastic waste. So I would like to request all the, if somebody is interested, really come forward to do a business on solid waste, they should practice first in their residence, or first their own practice, to practice their own. Then only they should come forward for the community activities or large scale activities. First, they should start from a micro scale or the household level activities. Then it will be sustainable and feasible. Thank you.
Right. Thank you so much for this. Yes, I think we should move on to the next question. Whoever put forth this question, I hope the query has been resolved. So now we do move on to the next question. So there are so many questions popping up on my screen right now, but I'm just trying to select the best views that I can right now. So this is addressed specifically to Dr. Shantanu Dutta. The question that has been put up is how and who to collect, treat / monitor residential e-waste and domestic biomedical waste.
Yes, Mr. Sagar, I can see the question from Mr. Rajesh.
Right. So if you would want to address that. So yeah.
For residential e-waste, we'll have the solution. If we are not having the solution at our hand now, but there are lots of effort from the government, from the Central Pollution Control Board, that producer responsibility organization, say for Samsung mobiles or other e-waste, they will give some collection centers. They will set up some collection centers in the city, and it will be publicized. Till now, that it is not coming to the public. We are not knowing who is the actually who is actually the waste collector in our city. But there are lots of pressure is there to this organization, to these PROs. There is authorization is given by Central Pollution Control Board, and in paper, in fact, it is there that this is the collection center we are setting up in their plan. We have to approve the plan, and then we have to verify whether it is, in fact, it is there or not. We are doing that verification with the help of State Pollution Control Board, sometime with ourselves. And in most of the cities so far in Northeast, in other places, I am not sure, that collection centers are not visible to the public. And we are making it a point that this, that all the PROs, means producer responsibility organization, they will make it public that this is our collection center. You can come and give your e-waste. Door-to-door collection of e-waste may not be feasible at this moment, but that collection center, designation collection center, if it is made public, then people will go and give it there definitely. And we are working on that. And very soon it will come. There are lots of good response. People are working on this, and we'll get the e-waste collection centers in the facility. Now, suppose for my office, it's a small office. We are generating lots of e-waste, say for old computers, printers and all. I'm trying to send it to Guwahati, because we are knowing it is coming up with Guwahati. Had it been in Shillong, one center is there in Shillong, it would have been easier for us. So that is the focus. In every cities sooner or later will have some, definitely will have the collection centers in where we can give the e-waste. Then the Mr. Rajesh, he raised about the question of disposal of domestic biomedical waste. Yes, we generate lots of domestic biomedical waste like the syringes and all. Even that mercury thermometer or mercury that pressure meters, sphygmomanometers, these are very hazardous. We should not throw it with the municipal waste, solid waste. Definitely, one drop of mercury waste can pollute a big pond of water. That I have read. So for my case, I tried to send it to the common biomedical waste management facility for my that pressure meter, pressure monitor. So you have to take special care for that mercury-based thermometer or pressure meters. Other waste, wherever is possible, if your healthcare center is nearby, their dustbin is color-coded dustbins are there. You collect it and you try to put it there. That is my suggestion. And it should not be mixed with the solid waste. That is what the rules say. And regarding the diapers, napkins, it should be packed properly before disposal with the solid waste itself. It is not that that dietary napkins and sanitary pads, these are not categorized as biomedical waste, but these are categorized as solid waste only, but it should be packed and then put together with the other waste. And you can send to that disposal system, maybe door-to-door collection and all. That is as per the provisions of the rules. Hope I had... Right.
So there's one question to Mr. Sanjay Gupta from Juri Chetri, that how we can make plastic waste recycling financially feasible as a startup in Assam. Would you like to answer that, Sanjay? And Amanjulita, did you share your screen? Somehow I'm only seeing your screen now.
Yes.
Can you stop? Can you stop sharing your screen? I'm seeing your screen now.
No, but can you visible? Are you looking me? Is it audible or not?
No, it's audible. I'm saying, Neeraj, are you also? Everyone is seeing Amadudi's screen.
Yes, that's what.
So you should stop stop share the button on the.
Yes, only Zoom is visible.
Yes.
Okay. Sanjay, would you like to see, kind of quickly touch upon how to make a plastic waste recycling plant viable? Maybe touch upon what kind of, what is the, minimum volume that you would require? What kind of mix from industrial and residential waste that you would need to make it viable? Would you like to quickly touch upon that?
Yes, I will. Thanks, Chetri, for the question. Plastic is a viable business. Let me tell you, in the entire world, India is the only country where 60 to 65% of plastic waste is recycled. So obviously it is a viable business, and most of them are now both in the formal and informal sector. So as a business and as a material, plastic is a viable business. The question that remains for the small towns is the volume. I have not seen a plastic industry which deals with less than 2 tons a day. So if you are able to aggregate 2 tons a day of plastic, particularly which is recyclable in the current scenario, for example, PET has very high demand. Polypropylene has very high demand. High density polyethylene of certain times are very high in demand. For example, milk pouch. So there are drop-off centers where people do collect in, for example, Goa, specifically with the milk pouch. The price of PET bottles in Assam varies from 18 rupees to 38 rupees, depending which city you are. So it could be sold in 18 rupees in a small town like Dumduma, and 36 to 38 rupees in a city like Guwahati. So it is a viable system if you get the volume right. And the machinery that is required to recycle it, whichever grade of recycling you want to do, whether you want to go for washing, grading, chipping, or making pallets, and then a final product, that's depend on you. But as a business material, it is pretty much viable if you can get the volumes.
Okay.
The highest material. It is the only material that gets highest recycling in India.
Right. So I think we have completed it, and by 3:45, as I targeted, about 15 minutes of Q&A.
But of course, we overshot the whole program by 45 minutes. But good, as long as there was a lot of engaging discussions. And just before we conclude, I would like to thank all the participants here for asking your questions. And I would like to ask Mr. Amitabh from IIE to give the concluding remarks.
Thank you all the speakers for this wonderful session and sharing the insights. Unfortunately, Sripurna ma'am could not join because of the visit from the Chief Minister of Assam to our office today. So
he could have joined the waste management program also. then we could have directly told our problems to him, right, Sanjay?
Yeah. Absolutely.
No need to go to the CPCB then.
Just a formal vote of thanks from the IIE NERIS team. Mr. Patrapatim, thanks for your input on the opportunities in the biomedical sector, in the areas of services, collection, disposal. And the practical advice shared by you that any concepts by startups would be innovative, feasible, and sustainable. So that's very good. Dr. Shantanu Dutta for giving us a very detailed insight on the regulations, the government policies and compliances, and also the challenges and solutions for biomedical in the US. That was very eye-opening for us. Dr. Sanjay Gupta, so we have come across a lot of things about you from the media, but anyway, thanks for sharing with us your initiatives in towns like Tinsukia, where you have done a lot of good work. And also, towards the end, where you briefed us about opportunities in the plastic sectors for entrepreneurs. So that was a very interesting insight. Dr. Amarjyoti Kashyap for sharing with us details of his innovations on waste assimilators, and I'm hopeful that some of our entrepreneurs, local entrepreneurs, can also work with you and do some in the area. And also that your advice that the source segregation to be given importance to community segregation. And last but not the least, Achitra for taking effectively the moderations and giving your inputs on the e-waste management. And was it really a wonderful session? I hope all our entrepreneurs who have joined, and apart from NERIS, other entrepreneurs also joined the session. It will be helpful for them to take forward their initiatives. Thank you, one and all. And thank you.
Good day. Thank you.
And we have missed a couple of few questions. So, if there are any further questions,
I think Ayanjit had a very pertinent question right at the beginning of the session, but due to lack of time, we are not able to. But if IIE can facilitate the discussion between Nayanjit, are you there? And Kostov had some question about the feasibility.
Yeah.
Yeah, sorry, I think.
That's okay.
Do you want to do the last question of the day?
No, I think partly it was answered by most of the panelists. So I was sort of curious about the ecosystem strengthening strategies within the Northeast environment post-COVID, given that a lot of opportunities as well as challenges do crop up in the waste management sector, whether it's plastic, whether it's biomedical, whether it's solid waste and municipal waste, as well as organic, manure production. I think there will be a lot of logistic and infrastructure related challenges as well as regulatory ones. What sort of ecosystem strengthening strategies are being considered would probably enlighten the entrepreneurs a lot. Maybe another discussion.
Okay. Yeah, I think infrastructure has always been a point of contention for a lot of entrepreneurs who have a great idea, but they have not been able to really take it to the next level because of other infrastructure constraints. I mean, not just Northeast. I do it in Bangalore, I do it in Mumbai, Pan India, and those infrastructure constraints remain. But maybe we Indians figure out a way to do this because there are so many constraints, right? And maybe we'll have a one-to-one chat once offline from this, yeah?
And
Sure.
I have shared an email ID, that's incubation.iie@gmail.com. So any of the participants have specific queries for any of the panelists, they can send it to the email ID, and then we'll put him in contact with a particular panelist.
Sure.
We also we can have any unanswered questions.
Thank you everyone for sparing almost 2 hours.
Thank you Asitra. Thank you Sanjay.
Thank you everyone.
Thank you everybody.
Thank you everybody. Okay.
Thank you Shantanu.
Thank you.
See you.
Thank you.